Do we understand the difference between the two? Because having $1 million, there's not a thing wrong with having $1 million. There's nothing wrong with that at all. But the condition of our heart would determine the choices we make with that money, whether or not it stays in our life or goes into our future. Like a person I ministered to one time who had $250,000, wham, just like that. They've never had that kind of money before. Man, they're a person that lived from paycheck to paycheck in life all the time. All of a sudden, wham, $250,000. Now, it may not be $1 million, but I doubt if anybody would turn it down. If somebody wanted to give it to you, I bet you'd receive it. It's like, thank you. That's $250,000. But you know what this guy told me? Here's the next year, just 1 year, and it went through his fingers like water. He's confused. He's like, where did it go? Because he can't say, you see, it didn't go into his future. Instead, it just went through his fingers, and he can't look and say, well, it's here or it's there. It's like it disappeared. See, that's the heart of a person that was not prepared for those kind of resources. You will live out of your heart in the condition that it's in. You'll make choices and decisions, and you'll find it exactly what's in your heart when you've got that in your hands. And if you're not prepared for those type of resources, then it won't go into your future. It'll be a temporary blessing, but it won't go into your future. And even if you tried to make it go into your future without understanding your heart, you would experience failure, disaster, confusion. You may think, well, God, I asked you to bless it. I prayed. Why didn't you do it? Why did you let this happen? You may not even be at a place of really coming to know His voice. Really in life, coming to know your own heart and the wise choices and wise decisions with handling those type of resources so they do go into your future. You may, if your heart's in condition of compulsion, man, you may start spending money. Wham, because you got it, what you've always wanted, that Corvette. Your neighbor's Mercedes, whatever. You know, whatever. I mean, you'll find out what's in your heart once it's in your hands is what I'm saying. But you see, Solomon chose wisdom. But let me tell you, he also was a king. David already put him in the position of a king when the Lord appeared to him and he chose and he asked the Lord for wisdom. So he didn't have lack in his life. He was a king. King doesn't have any problem getting money. It's just a matter of taxes. I mean, think about it. Get $1 from every single person in the U.S. and boy, what is that, $200 million or more? That's a lot of money for one individual. But a king, he already was in the position. But you see, the thing about asking for wisdom was this. It's the fact that what was in his heart. You see, you'll find out this when God shows up. You'll find out what's actually in your heart when it shows up. You'll find out if you're actually ready for the experience you have with Him. You'll discover whether or not, you'll see the condition of your heart at that time. Solomon's heart was already prepared for the visitation before he had the experience. He already understood the value and the benefit of wisdom. David said he had wisdom before God gave him wisdom. That's why he understood the benefit of wisdom. That's why he asked for wisdom. He was living it. It was already something he was living in. God just gave him more wisdom than any man on the earth. He saw the benefit of it. You see, in his heart, he didn't have the focus on himself. Take out my enemies. Give me wealth. Give me money so that I have no limitations as a king. I can do anything I want to do. That's all about me, isn't it? I'm at the center. And so my perspective is, this is what I need in order to operate in this position. I need money. And those that are trying to undermine me, man, I want my enemies destroyed so that I can actually have peace and not have someone trying to stab me in the back. I mean, even I can tell you stories here, even here in the U.S. I just heard one the other day about a person that was prospering greatly, made a decision through all of his business to funnel all of the finances into one central place to pay the bills out, and it just made sense. But it turned out that the multi-millions and millions of dollars that he was bringing in all these 12 different businesses, when he funneled all the finances into the one spot, it turned out that he was bringing so much finances in that he was hurting the local hospitals. They used their influence through the federal to shut him down, and they put him in prison for using the federal laws having to do with laundering money. Just by a business, he wasn't laundering money. He's paying his taxes, he wouldn't do it, but he's funneling all into one place so they could write all the checks to all the bills out of one place, not 12 different businesses. And so they shut him down so that the money would go back into the local hospitals. Now, that's wrong. It's not right, but that's the greed of man. So think about from that perspective. A king who has enemies, and they're trying to undermine, and they're trying to use even the legal system against him. You know, enemies that are undermining. So you know what? It doesn't matter how much money you have. You could be stepping on someone's toes, and they could have the influence to do something. Now, so a king is not without challenges, even though he may be a king. Not without problems. That's the point I'm trying to make. And just using that as an example. So the fact is this, though. Solomon didn't ask about himself. He didn't ask for his enemies. He didn't ask for wealth. Instead, he asked for wisdom and for the right motives to help these people. That's what David, Solomon's chosen out of all of his sons. He saw the wisdom, but he saw the heart of the man. David could see the part of the person. And so, you know what? Solomon was chosen, even with his weaknesses that came out in life later on. The fact was this, though, initially in the beginning, and his initial experience with the Lord, he asked for wisdom. You see, if you understand wisdom, wisdom is a practical truth, something being made practical that actually works where you get results in everyday life. Wisdom is where the rubber meets the road. Wisdom is how you see how it works in everyday life. Instead of just having something you choose to believe, but you don't get results and you don't fully understand how it all works. If you have wisdom, suddenly confusion goes, things get simple. Because your heart has understanding. You just see things differently. You can see what others can't see. Because you see with a heart of understanding. This is where people prosper sometimes in business, where others look at something and fear keeps them from making choices and decisions and going someplace. But they can look and immediately say, wow, I can make money with that. In no time, sure enough, they do. Finances come in. They do make money because they can see what others can't see. We're not talking about someone just making a foolish decision because they think something will work. We're talking about a person seen with understanding because they're already operating in it. They already have a heart of understanding. That person can experience failure and not be a failure, can process and it's just a challenge, and they can learn from it and succeeding and get better because they relate to life differently. Look at the people in our culture that the guy out in New York, I keep forgetting his name, he's a Republican guy that's been on television, that's wealthy like a billionaire. Trump, that's it, thank you. I mean, he lost his billions, went right back to being a billionaire later on. Once you are a millionaire or a billionaire, then your heart's still in that condition. You can lose it, but you know what? You're not a failure. It's just a matter of time until you can have it back because your heart's at a place that you have. So you're operating of understanding. You're not like a person who inherited the money like was in Reader's Digest back in the 70s out of Australia. This man inherited millions of dollars in Australia. And the reason he got in Reader's Digest was this. He got conned out of $1 million come out of some of the scams coming out of Africa. You remember when they were on the internet quite a bit? I don't know if you guys got email and things coming in, and it's not as prevalent anymore as much, but still there's some at times. But the reason he got scammed through the email and coming out of Africa was that the scam was so similar to the way he inherited his wealth. And it's like it hooked him. It's like, oh, yeah. And yeah, that's how I got my money. And so he gave them $1 million thinking that this investment was going to be great. He lost $1 million. Now, that's not why he was in Reader's Digest. The reason they wrote him up in Reader's Digest was this. He didn't lose it once. He got scammed in the same scam twice. He lost $2 million. It's like, what does the old saying go? Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I mean, he didn't, you know why? Because this man inherited his wealth. He didn't earn it. The man did not have a heart of understanding. He just had a lot of money. And a person whose heart is in that condition can lose and make unwise decisions because, you know what? They're just simply the condition of their heart. Is this making sense what I'm sharing with you? Our position in Christ, that we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing. We lack nothing, but it's spiritual. It's not natural. If you could have the $1 million right now, you may want it right now, but it's spiritual. God is a spirit. He relates by the spirit. And so if it's spiritual, okay, how does it manifest into the natural realm? How do you receive it? Because it goes on to say this, where the blessings are at is here. Every spiritual blessing, it says, in the heavenly places. So where are the heavenly places? And it goes on to say, in Christ. Now, in Christ is the position that you're going to receive these blessings from. You receive from who you are in Christ. You receive in your position in Christ, who you are in Him. What He's already accomplished for you at the cross. That's the position you receive. But where are they at? They're in the spiritual realm. They're in the heavenly realm. But do you see them in heaven? Do you see them as God needing to give you something and sitting in heaven and He's in waiting to give you something? Because if that's your perspective, wrong perspective. They're yours now. You must identify with them. You must own them. Stop identifying with lacks because you've been blessed with every spiritual blessing. Stop identifying with lacks. Stop identifying with not having. Because as long as that's in your heart, then that'll be who you are. That's the first thing that'll come out of your heart. That's what you identify with. Your heart must be at a condition, must be at a place of receiving. You must be open to receive based on Jesus. And so receiving is about Him, which means that He must become your life. Everything we receive from God is about Jesus Christ. Receiving is about Jesus. It's not about us. It's for us. But it's not about us. But if we make receiving about us, then we're identifying with our problems. And our problems are dominating our heart. And we want God to do something for us because I really need this. I really need your help. But He's already given us His help through Jesus Christ. And if that's the condition of your heart and your method, way of receiving, then that's where you see inconsistency. It takes a miracle to bypass your heart. That's the only way you'll receive is through a miracle. On the other hand, establish your heart in the blessings. No, I'm blessed. No, I expect good. I don't just want good. No, and I'm not making God do one thing. I'm opening my heart to receive what Jesus has accomplished at the cross. I'm a receiver. I am blessed. I expect blessings. I expect good. I have the favor of God. And that's real to my heart because He has already shown His favor through Jesus Christ. He loves me. Do you believe in His love? Has it been proven to your heart that He loves you? Or do you have difficulty believing He loves you because of all the bad you've experienced in life? Does your heart need to be healed? To where you allow the Lord to heal your heart and take away the hurt and take away the pain so that the Holy Spirit can be your teacher and He can help you in life and be your comforter. Is this making sense?
Yes.
We've been blessed with every spiritual blessing. We need to stop identifying with lack. Lack does not belong to us. Hate lack. Hate it with a passion. Don't yield to it. It's like you're not mine. Good belongs to you. Identify with it, own it. Amen. And then teach these principles to your children. Teach them in life how to own and identify with good. We're not talking about selfishness, self-centeredness. We're not talking about that. We're talking about our heart being established in truth to the point that good belongs to us, bad doesn't belong to us. And everybody experiences bad, so when you experience bad, you process through it quicker. It doesn't go into your future. Because it's like, no, you're not mine. That's not what Jesus paid the price for. No, I don't. You're not mine. I don't accept you. I don't identify with you. You're not mine. And it comes to pass. It just passes. You process through it. You gain wisdom. You gain insight because you turn to the Lord. When you experience any challenge and problems in life, you turn to Jesus immediately. You begin the Holy Spirit being your teacher. You get answers. You go through change, godly change in Christ. And suddenly you become that truth that's revealed to you and you're a different person. And now it's like, you know what? That can't work anymore because you're different. Mm-hmm. See, Two Christians can go through the same challenging, serious problem. One can turn to Jesus. The other can pull within themselves. One can get so hurt by the problem that they take it into their future. The other can go through a process of change where the Holy Spirit opens up God's Word to them. And they turn to Jesus and experience His faithfulness. And boy, they come out of it with smiles on their face, with the joy of the Lord. Let me say this a different way, or bring out a different truth. Romans chapter 15, verse 13 from the Amplified Version says this: may the God of your hope so fill you with all joy and peace in believing. In the process of believing, you're supposed to be experiencing joy and peace. That is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. That comes from the inside, through out of your spirit. Out of your spirit. A fruit of the Spirit is a spirit. It's out of your spirit. Galatians talks about the fruit of the Spirit. Joy and peace is a fruit. It's not just you being happy. You're experiencing the Holy Spirit in the process of believing. In the process of believing, you should be experiencing Him. Joy coming up from the inside, because when you identify with the goodness of God and problems lose their ability to dominate your heart, man, you get excited and you just, man, you hear about the Holy Spirit and what He says, you love it, you like it, you get so excited over His goodness, but there's joy. It just comes up out of your spirit. Joy. May the God of your hope, God is revealed to you as a God of expectation of good. Hope means expecting good, not just wanting good. He's the God of your hope. He's the God of good. The God of your hope. So, and He fills you with all joy and peace in that process of believing through the experience of your faith, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, in the process of believing, you should experience the Holy Spirit. It's not about what you do in the arm of the flesh and your own ability. If it's you just trying to make this stuff happen, your strength and your flesh is only going to take you so far, and then you'll crash and burn, and your own strength will give out eventually. If you're standing in the arm of your flesh and your own ability, you must learn to depend on the Holy Spirit. You must connect connect to Him instead of you trying to do it yourself. That by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound, be overflowing, bubbling over with hope. Just bubbling over with this expectation of good, because you identify with good. You own good. Good belongs to you. Because you know what? Bad doesn't belong to you. That truth has been revealed to you. You disown it. In the process of believing, the process of receiving from God, man, we should be experiencing the Holy Spirit. We should be experiencing good. There should be no discouragement at all, because we don't believe the problem. If we feel in our heart that discouragement starts to come, it's like, okay, where's that rooted? Okay, what am I believing that's wrong? Okay, that's not about Jesus. And it's just like we get our eyes right back on the Word of God. We look to the Word till it comes alive on the inside. That lie gets destroyed. It gets destroyed and it goes out of our heart. We cast our cares, 1 Peter 5:7, cast all of our cares upon the Lord. But you will not cast your cares upon the Lord if you're holding on to your problems according to what you believe about them. We cast all of our cares upon the Lord because He cares for us. Amen. But you won't believe He cares if you're believing the problem.
Yeah, come on. Amen.
Make sense?
Yeah.
My. If you cast your cares, but in your heart there's issues of unbelief that are unresolved, it's like you're fishing, and then you cast, but then you reel it back in. Just bring it right back in, because you're holding on to the problems according to what you believe about them. Your beliefs aren't established in Christ. You're not free of the problem. It has a hold on you. As Christians, we're supposed to walk free of anxiety. Anxiety is not supposed to be a way of life for us. It doesn't mean we don't have problems. It doesn't mean we can't experience the challenge of the problem. It just means that the challenge is short-term, not long-term, because we process through our challenges. You see, our human body is made to live with short-term stress and stay healthy. That's what doctors and scientists have determined. It's long-term stress that has a detrimental effect upon your human body. We are not made to live with anxiety, to live with it constantly, living with an anxiety, living with life's problems weighing us down, constantly weighing us down, where we can't get our mind and thoughts off the issues, where they dominate us, they affect us, they influence us, because we've got a hold of them according to what we believe about them, and they've got a hold of us. Praise God. I've said a whole bunch, but does that make sense? I've been focusing on receiving from God in a very, very practical way. I could give you the theological concepts of what Jesus accomplished on the cross and other things, and there's a lot more good teaching. It's not bad. It's just the fact that, you know what, this area of receiving is very practical and directly related to the heart of man, just like salvation involves the heart of a person. It's not just of the intellect. It's not just, okay, that sounds right. Okay, I guess I'll do it. And then tomorrow you hear something about Buddha and you go, oh, no, I think I'll go off and Buddha. It was never of the heart. If something comes from the heart of the person, immediately the Holy Spirit comes in and you change. And as Corinthians says, you're now a new creation in Christ. You have changed. So inwardly, on the inside, the old is gone, the new has come. In your spirit, you changed. You're different. My, that's the difference. Praise God.
Awesome.
Well, thank you, brother.
Awesome. Cecil Hand.
Well, there's teaching materials back there. And also, if you need prayer for anything, we're going to believe God. Amen? Amen. Let me, also, we're going to receive an offering. What is that?